because of all of us from the same area being together in one meeting like this. I don't know that that's not happened before, and that's something that may not happen again. It's so hard to get everybody together. I know Brother Chris even will not be with us until tomorrow, but it is a great blessing to be gathered with not only the brothers that we labor with in the ministry from our area, but also with you brothers here that labor in the ministry. I certainly rejoice in what we've heard. Very moving perspective of Andrew towards Jesus. And I want to talk to you from Matthew 27 and verse 16. Matthew 27 and verse 16, and give you three perspectives. A little bit different, a little more focused in on one particular moment of time, but hopefully all about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we've already heard here tonight. I want to give you a prisoner's perspective, I want to give you a princess perspective, and then I want to give you a praetorian perspective. Three P's. First of all, let's consider the prisoner perspective of what is happening in Matthew 27 and verse 16. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. They had a notable prisoner called Barabbas. The reason I pronounce that way is I do believe that would be the correct pronunciation. But I want you to see fully the picture of what is going on here as we consider first a prisoner's perspective. The prisoner, Barabbas, and we often refer to him as Barabbas. Here we have a man who was an insurrectionist. He was a rebel. He was probably among the group that was known as the Zealots. As a matter of fact, there was one of the apostles who was also in that group that probably, if he hadn't been with Jesus, would have been caught up in the insurrection that occurred whenever Barabbas caused the insurrection that he did, or at least participated in it. If you want to put that in perspective today to identify with this man was a terrorist, okay? That's what this man was. He was a zealot, which means that he was one who promoted the violent takeover of the Jews of Israel, taking their kingdom back from, or what they perceived as their kingdom, back from the Roman government. This man was a terrorist. He was waging jihad in these days before that was really known what that was. But he believed in killing in order to conquer and recover what they had lost. This was a very dangerous man. He was a notable prisoner, which we would say today that he was notorious. Someone who was infamous, one who was very mean and mean-spirited, and there was no quarter with this man. And yet he had been taken. It's amazing that he was even taken alive. But he had been taken in an insurrection where he had actually committed murder in that insurrection. I want you to get the picture of who this prisoner was. This Barabbas was a very dangerous terrorist who would be along the lines of something today that we would see when we speak of ISIS or some of these other terrorist cell groups that are out there. You don't want to be around this man, because there is no peace for this man until he accomplishes what he has set out to do, which is to have his government, his national Israel, take back over. Very dangerous man. And as Brother Luke presented such a beautiful picture of Andrew in the prison with another prisoner chained to him, I want you to picture the prisoner Barabbas in the prison here, not far from where the actual events were taking place. And at some point, he is brought into the actual events that are taking place. But if you can just imagine from a prisoner's perspective, if you will, the prisoner Barabbas, imagine what he is seeing, eventually what he sees, but what he is hearing. If you'll notice, there comes a point in Matthew 27 there where it says the chief priests and the elders were persuading the multitude that they would ask for Barabbas. As you know, this is where Pilate comes out there, and basically he puts the Jews, those that had gathered here, the multitude, to a test. He says, well, this is the time that we have a tradition here that we release a prisoner at this particular Jewish feast. And so he says, I'll see what their true intentions are, which he already basically knew that they had delivered Jesus up because of their jealousy of Jesus. This was not a pleasant time. This was not a peaceful time. This was not a time when Jesus was healing and doing the wonderful things that have been described. This is whenever he was having his second and third mock trial. And so here, these men come forward and they say, Pilate says, who would you have? Barabbas? Barabbas? I want you to understand why I'm pronouncing it that way, because Barabbas means son of the father. Abba, you, when the Spirit comes into the heart of a child of God, it cries, Abba, Father. That is another word for Father. It's a term of endearment. So here he presents Bar-Abbas, son of an earthly father. And he says, whom would you have? Bar-Abbas, the son of an earthly father? Or would you have Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the son who claims, he says he claims to be, which he was, but in Pilate's perspective, he claims to be the son of God. Would you rather have the son of man over here, the son of the father of an earthly man? Or would you rather have the son of God? And they demand Barabbas. They said, we'd rather have the son of an earthly man released. Is that not amazing? And what a testimony to the pitiful condition of man and his nature. When faced with the decision between being able to assist the Son of God and the King of Kings, they demand that a murderer, a terrorist, be released unto them. We can't imagine that. How would you like it if one of the governors, let's say, of New York or the President of the United States presented terrorists to be released? As a matter of fact, we've seen some of that happen down with Guantanamo, have we not? Oh, here's a terrorist. We'll release him. Or would you rather have the Son of God? They say, we'll take the terrorist. Now here's Barabbas in his prison, in his cell. Oh, can you imagine? He's probably smelled horrible, looked horrible, was in horrible condition, malnourished. He's angry. He's still a zealot. He's still an angry man. And so what does he hear? In Matthew 27, there around verse 20, 21, the governor asks them, he says, whether of the two of these will you that I release unto you? And you can hear the crowd go, Barabbas! Barabbas! And can you imagine what Barabbas heard? He heard his name, and he knew he was a condemned man. And there were three crosses being made that day, were there not? Two thieves, two other robbers. By the way, it says that Barabbas was also a robber. That means not just one who sneaks in the house and steals from you, or commits burglary. It means someone who would violently take something from you, as if they would walk up to you if they had a gun and said, give me all of your money and hit you over the head. He was a violent criminal. Obviously, he committed murder. And here's Barabbas in the prison, and what does he hear? Can you imagine how his eyes looked up and his eyes got bright and he got angry when he heard, Barabbas, Barabbas! And then Pilate goes on and he says, well, then what would you have me to do with the Christ? And they say, crucify him! What's the perspective of Barabbas? He's a dead man. He's a dead man. And then at some point they bring him out there. At some point he makes an appearance. And can you just picture him angry and mad and all upset and not even, who is this man, Jesus? Who is this Christ? He didn't even recognize this man over here. And then he comes out there ready to be strapped down to that cross and led to Golgotha and crucified with those other two malefactors. And they say, click, you're free. Can you think of any greater example of the substitutionary death of Jesus Christ? And I'm not making any judgment as to what kind of a man Barabbas was. I don't have any authority to do that. For all I know, he wasn't a child of God. He was just a wicked man of nature. But I also read about another thief that hung next to Jesus who was a wicked man by nature, cursing Jesus with every breath that he had and every bit of life that he had left in him. And the Lord born him again just a few minutes before he died. So, don't be too quick to judge the eternal destination of someone unless you read, like we do a few times, what their eternal destination is. Can you picture a more pitiful example of a just man dying for a wicked terrorist? I mean, I've said this before where it says of Jesus being dying the just for the unjust. Just, you say, I can't quite picture that, Brother Tim. Well, just picture the person you love the most in your life and you respect the most and is the most honest person in your life. And then imagine somebody from one of the state penitentiaries calling and saying, hey, we've got a convicted, confessed criminal, murderer, who's going to be put to death. And guess what? That person that you hold in such high esteem has voluntarily substituted themselves to die for that wicked person. So I just can't relate to that. Well, maybe that'll help you relate to it. Because this is the most innocent man that has ever lived. And one of the most guilty men that has ever walked the face, terrorists that has ever walked the face of this earth. Could you imagine? I cannot imagine. If my sweet mom or dad, who I hold in such high esteem, if they had called up, well, we called Osama bin Laden, you know. And Harold McCool is going to take his place to be executed. Oh, what? That's the most unfair thing I've ever heard. That's exactly what was happening here. That is the most unfair thing that you could ever hear a mob work up in their frenzy. We demand Barabbas to be released. We want the son of an earthly man. We don't want the Son of God. And Barabbas comes out. What is Jesus to him? He's just a getaway. He's the getaway car. He's out there ready to die, teeth gritted, ready to go to the cross and go down screaming and cursing. And they say, "You're free." What? So he can go and run the roads again and commit the things that he's done before again. It doesn't tell me that he learned anything from it. It does tell me in the book of Acts that when Peter convicted them there on the day of the Pentecost, it says that he said, "You desired a murderer to be released unto you." Don't you know that was convicting to those people? This Jesus Christ went about doing good and demonstrated his goodness by signs and miracles, and you demanded a murderer to be released unto you. And there goes Barabbas. Can you see him laughing and, "Boy, I got one on them." He didn't get anything on anybody. He didn't get anything on anybody. That's a prisoner perspective. What about a prince's perspective? It says in verse 19, when Pilate was set down on the judgment seat, his wife, Pilate was the governor, Pilate was the prince of the area, and his wife, the princess, the governoress, she sent unto him and she said, "Have thou nothing to do with that just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him." Now you heard Brother Luke describe a minute ago so eloquently how those apostles just fled like little scared children, which you say, "Well, I wouldn't have done that." You'd have done worse than that, and so would I. Don't think you wouldn't have done that. We'd have done just as bad or worse than they did. And all those apostles scattered. Isn't it strange that we have a testimony here from the most ironic of places? There was nobody there to testify for Jesus. There was nobody there to stand on his behalf. And yet you have this princess, this governoress, who is the wife of Pilate, coming forward and actually presenting a testimony to Jesus. He's a just man. Don't have anything to do with him. Now here it says that she had been daydreaming. At least that's what it says. She'd suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. I tell you, this is the kind of daydreaming I don't want. This woman was daydreaming. She was sleeping early in the morning, no doubt. And she is troubled. God has sent some kind of a dream to her. Now don't you put too much stock in dreams. The Old Testament says, if any man has a dream, well, let him tell it. But if any man has it, my word, let him speak it. What is the chaff to the wheat? In other words, a dream is just chaff. And I've had a lot of chaff in my life. I've had some of the craziest dreams to this day, I could hire out a psychiatrist to try to figure them out, and we still wouldn't figure them out. Where did that come from? I've never even seen that before. You know, to me, a dream in just its natural form can be just a super manifestation of your crazy depravity in your mind, you know? I mean, I could tell you some whoppers that I've had and think, where in the world did that come from? And you know, every night when my little girls pray, "Oh, Lord, help me not to have any bad dreams." We've all prayed that, haven't we? I don't want to have any bad dreams today. I had one here not too long ago that had something to do with Birmingham. It got me a little worried about coming to Birmingham, you know? Don't put a whole lot of stock in dreams. They're just manifestations, nocturnal manifestations of your crazy depravity is what it is. Now, that's Brother Tim's psychiatric definition of a dream, okay? You can mark that down. All right. But this woman has a dream, and in this dream, it is either revealed to her, or it is shown to her, or it is confirmed either from prior information that she had that Jesus was a just man. It says, and she sends a message to her husband. Why? Can you picture that? Pilate is sitting there on the judgment seat about to pass, wondering about what type of judgment to pass here towards Jesus. And he's sitting there thinking, and he says, "I've just presented Barabbas to them, and they've demanded a murderer, the son of a man from the earth, rather than what they call the Son of God over here." He's sitting here thinking, and he's going, "This is just bizarre." Well, the next thing I don't know, we get texts today, but when I get a text or a note from my wife, it's time to open it up. Well, you better open it up, brothers. When you get a note from your wife, don't ignore that text, don't ignore that email, don't ignore that phone call. Now, there's been times I know we just can't answer the phone, but if she calls back the second time immediately, that means you got to answer it. You hear me? So here's Pilate sitting on the judgment seat, and he's pondering all of this craziness that's happening around. How can these people want this murderer back? And here, hey, Pilate, there's a note from your wife.
What?
Doesn't she know what I'm doing? I mean, I'm the big man. I'm the governor. Give me the note. He opens it up and it says, "Do not have anything to do with this just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him." I bet he didn't wad that one up and throw it away. You know, I know he didn't wad it up and throw it away, because just a few verses down here, it says in verse 24, I believe it is, he says, "I am innocent of the blood of" who? "This just person." You see, apparently he listened to his wife a little bit. Of course, he wasn't innocent of the blood of Jesus, that's for sure. Here is a princess's perspective. In the strangest of places, in the most oddities, one of the most odd things you'll ever find, from a Roman princess, she comes and she testifies on, she is the only voice, aside from Jesus himself, that testifies on behalf of the Lord. She had a better testimony than Peter did he not? Did she not? Peter's over there cursing. "Man, I don't know the man." And he says something ugly. And then he goes off, you know, crying, weeping bitterly. And here's a Roman princess over here saying, "You better leave this guy alone. You better get away from him." Over there is the prisoner Barabbas running out the door. "Man, he is my getaway." And here's the Roman princess in here. And she said, "You need to get away from this man." And then you have the perspective of the praetorian. So what is a praetorian? Well, it says they led him into the praetorium hall. And the praetorium was the area in which the praetorian guard was stationed. The praetorian guard, the soldiers, as they are referred to here, are interesting. They're an interesting group of men. They would be like the Navy SEALs today. These are not just the average ordinary centurion or foot soldier. These men were a different breed of animal, if that's the way to put it. They were hardened. They were warmongers. And Edward Gibbons, when he wrote The Fall of the Roman Empire, noted that one of the first symptoms and cause of the decline of the Roman Empire was the Praetorian Guard. They became known as the kingmakers. Listen to me now. They became known as the kingmakers. They basically were a political party at this time, not so much in name, but in substance. And later in name, as years went by, hundreds of years went by, they became basically a political party. And if they put their man forward for emperor, that man was going in. You know why? Not because everybody voted for him, because you're going to have your head chopped off if you don't agree with them. See, we don't understand stuff like that. Everybody just, you know, picks up their toys and goes home around here, you know, when your candidate doesn't go into office. Well, in other places and in times gone by, they cut your head off, see? Matter of fact, several years ago, Elder Mike Ivey and I had a trip planned to Kenya to go and preach and be with Brother Martin. And I learned a valuable lesson to never, ever, ever. I wrote this down in my book of do's and don'ts. Do not ever plan a preaching trip when there is an election going on in a foreign country. Because there was rioting in Kenya. Because this man that they wanted to go in didn't go in. And they were hacking people up with machetes. So Brother Mike and Brother Tim made the wise decision to postpone that trip. Postpone it. You know, God gives you sense enough to know where to go and where not to go. Well, he gave us sense enough to know, don't go there right now. And of course, it calmed down after a period of time. It reminds me of what our brother Obey said, you know, about the Sudan years ago. Elder David Crawford and I were talking to Elder Obey while we're riding on a 13-hour bus ride. And Brother David was very curious about the Sudan. It's worse today in some ways in the Sudan than it was back then, back in 2006. And so Brother David said, Brother Obey, what do you think about the folks in Sudan? I mean, God's got children there, right? What do you think about going to Sudan? Is that possible? I mean, just give us your thoughts. And Brother Obey said, "Oh, Brother David, the Holy Ghost will take care of Sudan." Amen. And God's got a people there in the Sudan, just like he's got in Kenya, just like he's got in Alabama, just like he's got everywhere out of every kindred and tribe and nation. And that's exactly what Peter said in Acts 10 when he said, "I perceive that God has no respecter of persons, but in every nation him that feareth him is accepted with him." He didn't ask Peter to accept Christ, did he? He said, "You've already been accepted by God." How was that possible? By the finished work of Jesus. And that being applied to your heart in the new birth. He said the exact opposite of what is said today. Let's say what they said. Let's say what Peter said. So, the Praetorian, the kingmakers. What did the Praetorian see? Oh, I got 2 minutes, Brother Sam. Let's go out to pack this in quick. The Praetorian saw him scourged and stripped and spit upon. The Praetorian was salivating whenever Pilate finally turned him, Jesus, over to them. We got him now. And between 100 and 500 Praetorian guard took him into the hall Praetorium, and that's where the kingmakers mocked the King of Kings. He stood before him, and they scourged him, and they stripped him, and they spit upon him. They put a robe up in his hand. They put a reed in his hand, which was mocking his authority, mocking his visage, and ridiculing him, mocking him as what he was, which was the Son of God. The kingmakers making fun of the King of Kings. The Praetorian was there when they brought him vinegar. The Praetorian was there whenever the venom of the Pharisees was being spit out upon him and saying, "If thou be the Son of God, bring thyself down." The Praetorian was there gambling over the vesture of Jesus Christ. They didn't want to tear up that vesture. It was too valuable. They ripped some of his clothes in pieces and divided them up, but they gambled over that coat. He was there gambling over the vesture. He was there nailing the nails in his hands. The Praetorian was there when he heard a man hanging on the cross who should not have any energy or ability to speak. Takes in a big breath and cries out with a loud voice, "It is finished!" The Praetorian, you reckon he perked up when he heard that? And he heard him sigh, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And he's watched him there in the darkness as the lights had been turned off. He could see enough to know, to hear what was going on, and through the dimness see. And he died. He saw that. And the Praetorian was there, and he heard a rumbling from down within the ground, within the earth. And all of a sudden the ground began to shake. How would that make you feel right now? You'd feel unsettled, would you not? The ground begins to shake, and the rocks around him begin to split in two. And I don't know if he heard it or not. It was only about 600 yards away, but it says that the veil of the temple was ripped and rent in two. The veil of the temple was at least a foot thick. It had to make some kind of noise when it happened. And so here's the Praetorian. He hears the rumbling. He sees the rocks rent. He hears at least maybe the veil of the temple being ripped in two. And he became a believer. You hear me? It says, of all the people there, first of all, there were no apostles there. Maybe John was hanging out nearby. There were some women there. And of all the people there, the Praetorian, who saw him scourged and stripped and spit upon, saw the robe and the reed and the ridiculing, and he saw the vinegar that was all he was offered that he refused, and the venom of the Pharisees, and the vesture that he gambled over. Maybe he still held it in his hand or had it in his pack. He heard the cry, and he saw the sigh of Jesus, and he saw him die there before him. And he hears the rumbling, and he sees the ripping of the rocks, and he hears the possibly the veil of the temple being ripped in two, and he reaches a great conclusion here, and he says, surely this was the Son of God. The man who nailed the nails into his hand, the man who beat him and scourged him, the man looks upon him and he says, this had to be the Son of God for all of this to happen around me. Of all the witnesses to testify, oh my. What providence, what amazing grace that we see here. The very one that nailed the nails in his hands. And it says they sat down and they just watched him to mock him there to see what would happen. And he says, truly this was a righteous man. Truly this was the Son of God. And it says that he glorified God. Here's a child of God at the foot of the cross who just nailed him to the cross. You say, my case is too hard, Brother Tim. Are you kidding me? No case is too hard for the Savior. No case is too hard for His grace. So what is your perspective today? Do you see Him as something that you're like Barabbas and want to get away from Him? I'll just get away from Him. Let me tell you, as a child of God, you're not getting away from Jesus. I'll tell you that much. I like what the song says, which comes from when Jacob wrestled with him over there on the other side of the brook. It says that he held him in the darkness there. He didn't want to let him go. He said, I hold my Savior in my arms. I will not let Him go. That's the way we need to be. Some people say, well, I'd take it or leave it. Well, then I'm telling you, He won't leave you. That's for sure.
The Barabbas says, he's my getaway. The princess said, you need to get away from him. I'm telling you, child of God, you don't need to get away from him. The soldier said, the praetorian said, there's no getting away from this man. He's the Son of God. Are you scoffing at it like Barabbas? Do you scoff at it? Ha. Ah, the church, the tradition, this, that, and the other. Get your eyes off of that, the church, and the tradition, and get your eyes on the head of the church. Let me tell you, get your eyes on the Son of God. Get your eyes on Him and stop scoffing and stop mocking and stop seeing Him as a getaway and get busy holding on to Him. That's what I want to do. Oh, I tell you, if I don't hold on to Him, then I feel like I need to get away from Him. But if I'm holding on to Him, I just want to keep holding. And I want to be like Jacob, even though I don't know that he had the right motive, Brother Sam. But he did say, I will not let you go except you bless me. That's the way we ought to be. Are you scoffing at Him? Are you suffering like the wife of Pilate? She was suffering. Or are you like the soldier? Are you submitting? Of those three perspectives, from I am living proof, and I testify to you here today, that the one you will most enjoy is submitting to your Savior. Oh, it makes life so much easier. I'm not talking about all your troubles and trials going away. I'm talking about during those troubles and trials, recognizing that you've got a God in heaven that died on the cross for your sins, and He will never leave you nor forsake you, no matter what you face, no matter what you have to deal with in your life, no matter how hard it gets, and no matter how difficult it is, He is on your side. So act like you're on His side. There's no time for scoffing. And there's no time for suffering in the sense of the way Pilate's wife was suffering. Oh, the time is at hand, child of God. Submit. Follow the Lord. Embrace Him, because I've got good news for you. He's already embraced you. May the Lord bless you is my prayer.
What a wonderful way to spend a Friday night in the house of God, singing the hymns and hearing the gospel preached. I've been so encouraged and blessed in the preaching tonight, and I want us to turn to 154, because I think this song really captures what these brethren have been preaching to us tonight. Jesus Christ.